Friends, today I shall be talking on Coleridge's concept of imagination, or rather what Coleridge said about imagination, primary imagination, secondary imagination and fancy in his monumental work Biographia Literaria. But before coming on to Coleridge, we have to refer to the empirical philosophers. Now the question is, who are empirical philosophers? What is empirical philosophy? Empirical philosophy or empirical philosophers may suggest practical philosophy, practical philosophers. Philosophers who do not simply depend on concepts and contemplation, but on reality and matter. So these practical philosophers like Hobbes, Locke, Hume and Hartley, we should start with them. And they brought the concept of tabula rasa. What is tabula rasa? Tabula rasa means that the human mind is like a white sheet of paper, and external impressions are conveyed through our sense organs, and they get printed on the mind. The role of imagination, these philosophers believe, is severely restricted. Its function is as a mode of memory, opposed to the faculty of reason. Imagination, in other words, may be termed as, well, a mode of illusion making or castle building. Now, well, we may perhaps give an example. So when the human eye sees the green leaves, the image of the green leaves will get printed in the memory, and whenever the human being sees another such object, the human mind will immediately recognize it as the green leaf of a tree. Now this memory or this primary imagination is a common faculty of man. But Coleridge's concept of imagination is different. Coleridge believed that, or considered, rather, he considered imagination as an ensemplastic power. Once again, let me repeat, an ensemplastic power. What does it mean? It means that imagination has the power to shape disparate things into a unified whole. So imagination has a magical and a synthetic power, and it performs triple functions. What are these three functions? Number one, it has its synthetic power. Number two, it has its power of resolving or it has its power of resolution of, well, different things, and resolution of the dialectic between mind and nature. Once again, what is the second function? Imagination has the power of resolution of the dialectic between mind and nature. Now, what I said just now, the mind will immediately recognize what it registered previously through one of these sense organs. It may be a sound, it may be a visual, it may be a smell or anything else. And, well, imagination has a third very important power. What is that? It converts, or it rather connects, not converts, it connects external nature to the self-conscious mind. Imagination connects the external nature to the self-conscious mind. In different chapters of La Biographia Literaria, chapter 7, chapter 12, chapter 13, chapter 14, Coleridge discusses different aspects of imagination. And so, imagination is also another thing that can connect the existence of matter with the essence of the ideal form. Well, and Coleridge definitely speaks of different degrees of imagination, about which I shall be talking right now. What are these different degrees of imagination? For example, he says that the imagination of the superior degree, well, is used in poetry. Primary imagination is the prime agent of all human perceptions. But the imagination, which is of a superior degree, is secondary imagination. And this secondary imagination differs, very much differs in degree from the primary imagination. Although we can say that at the same time, secondary imagination is also an echo of the former, that is, primary imagination. So secondary imagination definitely is of a superior degree, but that does not mean that secondary imagination is completely different from primary imagination, because they are closely connected. Only secondary imagination is of a superior degree. Coleridge also says, especially in chapter 12, Coleridge says that primary imagination is the living power and prime agent of all human perceptions. So primary imagination is the living power and the prime agent of all human perceptions. And secondary imagination is the echo of the former, coexisting with the conscious will, yet as identical with the primary imagination in the kind of its agency. What does secondary imagination do? Secondary imagination dissolves, diffuses, dissipates in order to create. It suggests, it can idealize, and it can unify. So secondary imagination can idealize and it can unify. Now I can give you an example, a very simple example of secondary imagination used in a poem by William Wordsworth. Well, when we can see and we can understand very easily that secondary imagination is an echo of the primary imagination, but superior in degree. Well, let us take this line from Wordsworth. When she I loved looked every day as fresh as a rose in June. Now, the image of a rose definitely is imprinted in the memory of the human being, here the poet. But here the poet is connecting the image of the rose with the appearance of a girl. So the girl becomes a rose, or rather the girl gets connected with the rose. The girl is as beautiful, as fresh as the rose in June is. So this is secondary imagination. This is imagination of a superior degree. Now when I have seen a rose or smelt its fragrance earlier, the moment I see a flower, I can recognize that it is a rose. But connecting a rose with a beautiful girl and comparing a beautiful girl with a rose is a different thing. The second one is an example of secondary imagination. Secondary imagination is therefore basically a creative or poetic imagination. What is secondary imagination? It is a creative or a poetic imagination. Well, let us refer to the line that I have just recited. Well, this is creative and poetic because the girl and the rose are connected. The girl becomes a rose, or the rose becomes a girl. So creative and poetic imagination, that is secondary imagination. Or in other words, poetic or secondary imagination becomes the fullest exercise of the self. The self-consciousness of the poet is exercised in the fullest form only in secondary imagination. And its inner power is used to the full. And the free will of the poet or the creator can control it. And the free will of the poet directs the creative activity or art. The free will directs the creative activity as it controls the creative activity of the poet. Now, what is fancy? And I shall talk about fancy in greater detail, but very simply, fancy is no other than a mode of memory. Fancy is no other than a mode of memory. And it is emancipated from the outer world of time and space. So, fancy is definitely of a lower order. Of a lower order, fancy is of a lower order. And we can try to analyze the difference between fancy and imagination. And in order to understand the difference, we have to refer to the Greek word phantasia. Phantasia, which has a suggestion of the free will of the mind. Phantasia has the suggestion of the free will of the mind. And, well, the Latin word imaginatio, with a stress on concrete and sensory, was the inferior power. And we say that the Latin imaginatio may suggest the meaning of fancy, as Coleridge uses it. Now I'll talk about a few critiques and what they have said about fancy. I'll talk about that. According to James Beattie, imagination and fancy are not synonymous. Imagination and fancy are not synonymous. Fancy, like wheat, is an unusual form of association. So once again, fancy, like wheat, is an unusual form of association. Fancy, like wheat, is an unusual form of association. And it is an it may be an association of ideas or images. Imagination is inventive and plastic, but fancy is not. Imagination is inventive, but fancy is not inventive. Then I shall come to Steward, D. Steward, Dugald Steward. What he says about fancy is this. He says, imagination is comprehensive, is a comprehensive function of the mind that combines fancy with conception. Once again, imagination is a comprehensive function of the mind that combines fancy with conception. So, fancy is definitely inferior, much inferior to the faculty of secondary imagination. John Moyer, M-O-I-R, John Moyer says, fancy does not feign, F-E-I-G-N, fancy does not feign objects unknown to the senses. Its function is embellishing them, connecting them, disposing them in attitudes and groups. Imagination can create and fabricate, but fancy cannot. But fancy cannot. Coleridge says that primary imagination is a living power. Primary imagination is a living power, and it is the prime agent of human perception. Primary imagination is the living power, and it is the prime agent of human perception. And it operates, primary imagination operates through direct contact between mind and nature. And as I said earlier also, when I see a green leaf, I see means I use my visual organ and I connect it with external nature. I see a leaf and the image of the leaf is imprinted in my memory. So it is said that primary imagination operates through direct contact between mind and nature. And so mind is finite and nature is infinite. So primary imagination is both spontaneous and involuntary. So it primary imagination therefore tries to establish a connection between finite mind and infinite nature. Secondary imagination, on the other hand, is, as I said earlier also, is poetic. It is creative and it has an implication of the knowledge of philosophy. In chapter 7 of Biographia Literaria, Coleridge says that secondary imagination in all its degrees and determination is connected with the primary imagination. So secondary imagination is not completely different. As I said earlier also, it is an echo of the primary imagination also. Secondary imagination, well, becomes the fullest exercise of the self. Secondary imagination becomes the fullest exercise of the self and its inner power. So, secondary imagination creates new images. Now, once again, let me take the example of the line that I quoted or recited earlier. So it creates something new, a new image, the image of a girl who is like a rose. That is secondary imagination. Fancy, as I have said, is definitely inferior, much inferior, because, well, it cannot be compared with either the primary or the secondary imagination. It cannot be compared with the secondary imagination. So what is primary imagination? If we make a summary of what we have said, what is primary imagination? Primary imagination is creative. Primary imagination is original. And primary imagination is unconscious. Yes, very important, unconscious. Because as I see, well, in the visual that comes to me through my sense organ, is a transmission of the unconscious process. I see the image of the leaf. I see the image of the green leaf, or I hear the whistle of a sweet whistle of a bird. They are coming to me through my sense organs, unconsciously. I do not have to put in any conscious effort. So, primary imagination is creative, original, and unconscious. Well, and primary imagination has the basic power to give the chaotic world a shape, a form of order. Only through primary imagination we create our own visual and auditory and other aspects of the world. We understand the world only through primary imagination. And secondary imagination, of course, as I have been telling you, well, it is an echo of the primary imagination, but it is a poetic faculty. So in our summing up, we can say secondary imagination is a poetic faculty which not only gives shape and order to a given world, but builds new worlds. So in primary imagination, I see the tree, I see the leaves, I see the flowers, I see the fruits, and I build a world. That a tree is something that has green leaves, that bear flowers and fruits, and shelter birds and other animals. So I create my world through primary imagination. But what does secondary imagination do? Secondary imagination can help us to build new worlds. So, well, you know, we can take another example from another poem. Now, well, once again, well, I'll take another line from Wordsworth, because Wordsworth, some of the poems of Wordsworth are so simple and so easy. Therefore, I take another example, and well, from a poem which is very well known. I wandered lonely as a cloud. I wandered lonely as a cloud. Now, well, you know, we can understand how the poet is comparing himself with the cloud, the floating clouds. The floating clouds floating without any destination. The poet was roaming, roaming without any destination, without any specific destination. So, the poet, the personality of the poet as a human being becomes cloud. The poet and the cloud are as if equated. So a new world is created through secondary imagination. And what is fancy? A fancy is often said to be a kind of logical faculty. And it is the mechanical ability of the poet to use fancy and in poetry he uses fancy in order to blend various ingredients into various beautiful images. There are two cardinal points. There are two cardinal points of poetry. What are they? Number one, poetry excites sympathy to the reader by a faithful adherence to the truth of nature. Once again, poetry excites sympathy to the reader by a faithful adherence to the truth of nature. And Number two, the novelty that the poet uses by modifying colors of imagination. Colors of imagination are modified. Well, we can quote a few lines from a poem to make the whole thing clear. For example, well, a very simple poem, once again, a very simple poem. Say, a simple poem by Shelley. Well, Shelley's Skylark. Hail to thee, blithe spirit, bird thou never art, that from heaven or near it pourest thy heart in profuse strains of unpremeditated art. Pourest thy heart, let us take this line, pourest thy heart. The pouring, you know, pouring, as if, well, there is a pot, and from the pot, water is being poured. So the music of the bird is being compared to pourings. Music is as if being poured from the heart of the bird. So, well, we can see the image. We can try to understand the image. And at the same time, we understand how nature is being modified by the poet. Because, well, you know, an object like a pot is not there in the world of the skylark. What does the poet mean? Does the poet mean the heart of the skylark? Or the voice of the skylark? The music of the skylark, definitely. But where from does the music come? Does it come from its voice, from its heart? So, well, a concrete image is being used by the poet, a concrete image with which the human world is familiar. Pourest thy heart, as if heart is a pot, a receptacle from which the music, which is like liquid, is getting poured. So how the poet changes and builds a new world, a new visual, that is the act of secondary imagination. Well, you know, it is said, some critics say that, well, fancy is not poetic. What is fancy then? Fancy is aggregative and associative. Fancy is a mode of memory. Fancy is also a mode of memory. Fancy can join without blending. It works together with the pre-existing sensations without wishing anything or using anything original and new. So, fancy is not poetic because it does not use anything original or new. And therefore, fancy is definitely an inferior form of imagination and fancy much inferior to secondary imagination. Now, well, you know, for the present, perhaps we can try to end here. But before I end, let me remind you that Coleridge suggests that imagination basically means a power of organization. And this power of organization we can find both in primary imagination and in secondary imagination. So let me repeat, what is imagination? Imagination is a faculty of organization. Well, fancy is mechanical and therefore it is inferior. And some other critics have said that fancy is no other than a mode of memory. Fancy is no other than a mode of memory, only emancipated from the order of time and space. So, well, that is briefly Coleridge's theory of imagination, primary imagination, secondary imagination, and fancy. And so, for this evening, goodbye. I shall come with another topic on some other day. Thank you.